competition so keen, affecting both players and spectators alike, turning casual friends into bitter enemies. Tonight's game looks like a sellout. A capacity crowd of thousands of rabid sports-loving hockey fans has turned out to cheer for their favorite team. Yes, sir, the stands are filling up. They're really packing them in. A hush of expectancy settles over the crowd as the teams line up for the faceoff. The referee drops the puck, and the game is on!
The sport of hockey had its ties with the Walt Disney Company long before the entertainment giant acquired an NHL team of its own in 1992. Inspired by the hit movie, The Mighty Ducks, Disney Sports Enterprises has positioned a team for the 1990s, where entertainment is every bit as important as performance. Yesterday, the players had their very own parade down Main Street, USA, and where else? Disneyland. And tonight, the Ducks come into their brand new pond, and the fans will wait in by the thousands as a new era begins. Welcome to the new home of the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, the beautiful new Arrowhead Pond of Anaheim, where tonight hockey history will be made before a sellout crowd as the brand spanking new Mighty Ducks of Anaheim play their first ever game against one of the original six teams, the Detroit Red Wings. And hello, everyone. For National Hockey Night on ESPN2, I'm Tom Meese, welcoming Brian Engblom. Brian, you played with an original six club in Montreal. You know something about what it takes to win Stanley Cups. An interesting contrast tonight, a proud franchise from Detroit, a brand new one here in Anaheim.
It'll be interesting to watch for sure. Detroit is certainly the team with the talent up front and the likes of Paul Coffey coming from behind. Anaheim is the team that's really going to have to react, do a good job in the neutral zone, try and get some outnumbered attacks and steal some goals and sit on a lead, hopefully.
Well, they have a sellout crowd here, and a lot of hoopla is going to be made about the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, and rightfully so here in Southern California. But you mentioned the Detroit Red Wings and their talent. They are loaded with stars, and in fact, 103 points last year. This is one of the NHL's best teams.
There's no doubt about that. These guys have really put the puck in the net with the likes of Yzerman, Fedorov, Cicerelli up front, and again, Paul Coffey coming from behind. These guys can really put the puck in the net. Yzerman, over 1,000 career points. He had another season of over 100 points and his 50-goal season. This guy can do it all up front, and he'll be ready for another great one, I'm sure, this season.
For our first telecast from the brand-new Arrowhead Pond of Anaheim, let's go now to our roving reporter, none other than Al Morganti, who's at the entrance of this state-of-the-art building. Al.
When you wish upon a star, this is what you get. The NHL goes through an archway into a new era, the NHL in Disneyland. Walk through these doors. You get your duck call, opening night at the pond for the Ducks. Tom, hang on to your seat. It's going to be a great show. You don't want to miss a minute of it.
Al, I owe you an apology. Do you think I once said you couldn't carry a tune? You are do wonders with that Mighty Duck kazoo. I got to tell you that. And we'll... Welcome back to the new Arrowhead Pond in Anaheim, California, home of the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. In just a few moments, when the house lights come back up, we're going to have a pre-game ice show courtesy of the folks at Disney Productions, and you know that that's going to be something to see, and the fans here are eagerly anticipating that show coming your way, and we'll carry it for you in its entirety right here on ESPN2's National Hockey Night. But you know, Brian, living here in Southern California as one of the radio voices of the Los Angeles Kings during the season, you've been able to chronicle as a league how it's gone from 50 million just about 5 years ago to 800 million last season of 92 and 93, and already the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, Brian, they outsell in their merchandise every team in the NBA, every team in the National Football League, and every team in Major League Baseball. To put it succinctly, they're the hottest item in sports right now.
Unbelievable. Well, it was set, I think the tone was set a couple of years ago up in San Jose. San Jose did an outstanding job of marketing. Their stuff was selling like hotcakes for the last 2 years. They've done a great job, and Disney has their work cut out for them, and I'm sure they like that. They want to have a goal to shoot for, and that's a lofty goal and a very good goal for them to head towards.
You know, one point we want to hit tonight, I guess now's as good a time as any, as you take a look at the crowd and anxious anticipation. Hockey purists, when the franchise was granted to Michael Eisner and the Disney Company, they said, oh yeah, right, you're going to have a team in Southern California, they'll probably call it the Mighty Ducks. Yeah, well, they did, and there was a lot of snickering after the name and the logo was announced. Nobody's laughing anymore.
No, that's true. And if you think about it, hockey purists, I probably consider myself a hockey purist as well, and your first thought is, well, the Mighty Ducks, why should they do that?
Especially in hockey. Not so here at the pond in Anaheim. This place may be the biggest and best locker room in the National Hockey League. First of all, it's so big, you could play racquetball in this place. Well, never mind racquetball, you don't have time for that. How about a little ping pong? And of course, there's everything here in Anaheim. You've got your own Mighty Ducks logo right on the table for you. So you come in, maybe you want to view some parts of the game or other games from around the league. So the defensemen look at one screen. Maybe the left wingers look at the screen over here. The right winger wants to take a look at a right wing on the East Coast. He's got his own screen. And the goaltenders, they want something else? Well, there's four screens up there to watch from.
The depths of the pond, the mighty Iceman cometh.
Somebody scream! Defenseman number two, Bobby Dolan. Defenseman number three, Mark Berner. Defenseman number four, David Williams. Defenseman number six, John Hill. Defenseman number seven, Alexi Nazitana. Defenseman number 23, Bill Holder. Defenseman number 29, Randy Lattiser. Defenseman number 44, Miles O'Connor. Center number 8, Tim Sweeney. Left winger number 14, Joe Sacco. Right winger number 17, Stephen King. Left winger number 18, Gary Paul. Left winger number 19, Anatoly Semenov. Center number 20, Bob Horta. Left winger number 21, Patrick Kernbach. Center number 22, John Bennett Allen. Left winger number 24, Troy Mooney. Center number 25, Gary King. Right winger number 26, Robin Fowler. Left winger number 32, Sue Grimson. Right winger number 33, Jim Thompson. Right winger number 36, Todd Newman. Assistant coaches, Al Sims and Tim Harvey. And the head coach of the Mighty Ducks, Ron Wilson. Ladies and gentlemen, your 1993 Mighty Ducks of
participants in the ice show, another excellent production from the Disney Company, and I think Brian Engblom truly a night to remember for the players as well, the new Mighty Ducks of Anaheim as they take the ice for the first time in the regular season. We'll be back in just a moment. It's National Hockey Night on ESPN2, a special evening for the gathering, the sellout crowd here at the new Arrowhead Pond of Anaheim as they're settling in their seats.
You can't name a hockey team after a movie, not the Mighty Ducks, but there were others that said, do not bet against Michael Eisner and don't bet against Disney. This team will be successful and profitable immediately. And you know, the Mighty Ducks have not even played their first regular season game here at the pond, but from coast to coast, from north to south, the whole world seems to be talking about the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim.
One, two, three.
Quack, quack.
In December of 92, the NHL awarded a franchise to the Disney Corporation, and by March, Michael Eisner unveiled the Mighty Ducks. Then came the Pond, a brand new state-of-the-art Anaheim arena. The Mighty Ducks is a team inspired by the Disney movie in which actor Emilio Estevez whipped a bunch of young misfits into a hockey team.
Here it comes. Nice and easy. Good.
I did it.
All right.
Yeah, he did it, and the Ducks hope to do it by sending an early message to the other teams in their division. A message about skill players such as Yake and Semenov and King. Okay, they're not quite household names yet, but new head coach Ron Wilson seems to like what they're being called.
When you look at our lineup, you more or less have to agree we're the muscular waterfall.
To create a following, the Mighty Ducks, as a result of the movie and the Disney name, already have fans, not only in Anaheim, but across the country. Sales of their merchandise already far exceed every other NHL team. With hit movies like...
We'll be ready for the face-off in a few moments, but our roving reporter Al Morgante has decided to go shopping, courtesy of the Espen expense account. Al, you're in the store.
I'm at the Anaheim Ducks team store, and wow, what a team store. Anything you want, and of course, the number one item, you got it. This jacket, maximum 250 made, special number for each jacket made. I've gotten a number 19, 18 sold already. The price tag, only $1,300, so the expense account might be a bit inflated. If it's not the jacket, plenty of glasses, hats. They've done about everything you can do with a duck's face, even on the hats. For the kids, T-shirts, Mighty Ducks bibs, the usual jacket to usually get. Now, this logo got so-so reviews, now accounts for 65% of all NHL merchandise sold already. Of course, Disney does some special things. You've got the face of a duck on Mount Rushmore. Everything over here, front and back T-shirts. And, of course, special for tonight, I was there.
And also there, Emilio Estevez and Paula Abdul. Take my word for it. The house lights are out, but there they are, Emilio and Paula. By the way, Al Morgante, who looks marvelous in leather. Of course, Emilio Estevez on the left there, the star of the original Disney movie, The Mighty Ducks. And I understand they're making a sequel to that.
So I hear the first one was a big, big success, and they're ready for number two already.
And we're almost ready for hockey here at the Pond. Believe it or not, after all the pregame festivities, and I say believe it or not because now the teams have to come out, Brian Engblom, they have to warm up again. They had their pregame skating. It's been almost an hour since both the Ducks and the Red Wings have come out and had any activity. What kind of effect can this have as we look at Stevie Eiserman?
Yeah, it's a tough situation. They had to go through this in Dallas the other night, almost an hour in between the warm-up and when they get going. That's an extraordinary amount of time. And especially for the kids who want to get going their first pro game in the NHL, it's so tough. You're so tense all the way along, and when you have to sit there for an entire hour and wait for it, it makes it that much worse.
Well, the smoke is cleared, most of it, but that's not for, this is a non-smoking building. Let's make that clear. So the fireworks that they had a few moments ago, and really the butterflies, though, that have to be going through the stomach of head coach Ron Wilson of the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, an assistant for several years with the Vancouver Canucks, a very successful program, but this is his first head coaching assignment.
Yeah, it's quite an assignment for him. It's quite an assignment for this whole franchise. They've done a great job here at getting things.
Well, I visited with him in Disneyland yesterday, saying that I said, "What do you think about all the hoopla? You come from a traditional hockey background. What about all the hoopla and all the hype and everything?" He says, "This is the wave of the future. The NHL has to move in this direction, and I'm glad that my franchise is right at the forefront of it." Scotty Bowman, of course. Well, he only has more wins than anyone in National Hockey League history. He is first in just about every coaching category, playoff victories total, 22nd season as a head coach. And you played for him, so you know him better than most people, Brian.
Scotty Bowman is a great, great coach, 22nd year of coaching. He's trying to take his fourth team to the Stanley Cup Finals.
The PA announcer introducing the starting lineup for the Detroit Red Wings, greeted by a round of boos. We're going to have a special. I can tell you that Guy Hebert, who played the last couple of seasons with the St. Louis Blues in a backup role to Curtis Joseph, will get the start tonight. There is he, Alexei Kasatanov, former New Jersey Devil. And he'll be joined by the alternate captain, Randy Lattisour, came over from the Hartford Whalers. That's the back line. Troy Loney, the team captain, the former Pittsburgh Penguin. Anatoly Semenov, former Edmonton Oiler. He's traveled around early in his NHL career.
He sure has. It'll be interesting to see how he plays here this year. Last year, of course, he had some pretty good success playing with a guy named Pavel Bure up in Vancouver.
And Terry Yank, the former Hartford Whaler, rounds out the starting lineup for the Mighty Ducks. And now for the national anthem, Melissa Etheridge. Let's go to our PA announcer.
Melissa Etheridge.
Holds five times. This is his 11th year in the NHL, already over 1,000 career points. He can do it all. He's got great speed. He has great change of pace, makes tremendous plays, has been playing a lot with Fedorov, and this guy can finish off what Stevie gives him.
All right, Peter Ng will be the starting goaltender for the Detroit Red Wings. Tim Chevalier is out with a minor knee injury. Guy Hebert for the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. We're ready to go. Referee Ron Hogarth drops the puck, and action is underway. For real, the first game ever. When it counts for the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. Going back for the puck is Alexei Kasatanov. Kasatanov behind his own net comes to center. He's got Yake on his right wing, and Kasatanov dumps it in. Peter Ng leaves it around the boards. Ray Shepard clears the zone for Detroit. Here's Bob Colbert. Probert gets it over to Fedorov. Fedorov the shot and the save, the glove save made by Guy Hebert, and he'll hang on for the faceoff.
Guy Hebert probably has one of the most thankless jobs in the house right now from the standpoint he's been sitting there for an hour like everybody else, but he's the goaltender, the home goaltender for a new franchise. If one gets by him early on, he's going to disappoint all his fans. I wouldn't want to be Hebert. He's an excellent goaltender, though, and he's ready for it.
So the faceoff will be in the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim zone. It'll be to the right of Guy Hebert. The officiating crew tonight, Rod Hogarth, the referee, the linesmen are Michael Civic, all 6 feet, 7 inches of him, and Lyle Sykes. And the Red Wings control the faceoff back to the point. Paul Coffey lets go a blast, and another glove save by Hebert. I'll tell you, that's where the Wings want to have Coffey stationed on that faceoff.
Absolutely. Paul Coffey can pass the puck as well as anybody in the NHL, but he has a great shot. Right from the faceoff, we'll see the point. The faceoff won cleanly by Detroit. Faceoff so important in the NHL. You must do a good job on them. Detroit did a great job on that one.
Randy Lattisure actually created a little bit of a screen for his own goaltender going out trying to block that shot, but Hebert kept sight of it and made a rather routine save and a hard shot. Coffey behind his own end has it taken away. Loose puck in front. The Ducks can't convert, though. Detroit has a 2-on-1, maybe a 3-on-1. Dallas Drake on the left wing moves in. Drake passes and not controlling the puck, and thereby not scoring, was Mike Sillinger. Hebert sprawls, but Sillinger had the goaltender at his mercy and just couldn't control the pass.
What a great chance there by Detroit after Kazatonov got caught up the ice. It was a 3-on-1 situation. You have Probert carrying the puck coming up the ice. He does a great job here setting up the play. Lattisure is the guy sliding across trying to make the save. Excuse me, it's Drake with the puck. Mm-hmm. And the shot comes across. It goes off the heel of a stick. He almost got it. Sillinger tried to put it home, but couldn't quite control it.
And there's Dallas Drake, who has to be sitting there thinking, I should have had an assist by now.
That's right.
Because if Sillinger controls that pass, half the net was open. No way Hebert could have gotten over there. Corkum and Eisenman line up for the next faceoff, and Eisenman is tossed out. A big Keith Primo, 6 feet five, number 55, is on there for Detroit. Primo tries to control it, can't do so. Now Eisenman picks up a loose puck. Behind the net and back forward for the Mighty Ducks, Sean Hill, the former Montreal Canadian, coming over in the expansion draft. Corkum at center ice. He's bodied off the puck by Terry Kartner, who just joined the Red Wing team in a trade from Philadelphia. A lot of players on both teams, new locations as they begin this 93-94 season. The puck was on the mesh, but was not tied up, and the referee, Hogarth, said play on. Ducks pressing the forechecking attack at the Detroit blue line, and finally an offsides is called, and we'll have another faceoff with 18:33 left here, first period. There's a look at big Keith Primo, and Scotty Bowman really likes this youngster.
He sure does. He is a big man. He can play the wing. He can play center. I think they would like to give him a lot of time at center ice, but number 19, Steve Yzerman, is the guy who's out there most of the time. Primo's got all the chances in the world on this team. Scotty Bowman will give him every chance, I think, early on in the season. They want to see if he can be a goal scorer on top of doing a good job in the corners and controlling the puck.
Face off the Red Wings. Terry Kartner in his own zone. Now looks it out the center. Looks to his right wing. Bouncing a pass off the boards. Johnson. Recent acquisition for the other Dino Cicerelli. I'm sorry, he's not a recent acquisition. Cicerelli, the pass back to Kartner. Winding up with a shot is Shepard. His shot was high and wide. Kartner keeps it in. Primo on the backhand. He can't get it away. Sean Hill does for the Mighty Ducks at center ice. The shot there taken by number 18, Gary Volk, the former Vancouver Canuck. And the Ducks will get a line change. Here's Primo at center. And now Detroit will go for a line change. Best scoring chances, in fact, the only ones who come from the Detroit Red Wings early on, but no score. The Mighty Ducks of Anaheim are for real, as of tonight. Actually, they had a pretty good preseason. Won a couple of games. And there's the first goal of the game by the Red Wings. Aaron Ward took the shot from just inside the blue line. And Aaron Ward puts the Red Wings on the board.
Aaron Ward with the heavy shot from the blue line. That one was redirected, Tom. We'll have to see if there was touched in front by anybody. Probert was down low. I don't know if he got his stick on it or not. We'll try and pick it up on the replay. But a good blast by Ward from the point. We see the puck being shot now. There's Probert on the edge of the crease. It's a bit difficult to tell from that angle whether he did get a stick on it, but there was really no chance for Hebert on that one.
Aaron Ward, a three-year performer at the University of Michigan, also played on the Canadian national team, coming over from the Winnipeg Jet organization, has given the Red Wings a 1-0 lead. And that quiets down the crowd a lot. However, and to be realistic, we're going to have to get used to a few pucks going into the net this year with an expansion.
I think so.
Now the one thing, actually, the two things that the Ducks lack are team speed and a lot of scoring. And that's typical with an expansion team, isn't it?
That's right, absolutely. They're going to have to try and play a good, close, tight-checking game in a neutral zone, try and play a good defensive game, try and get those turnovers and some out-and-out attacks, and then try and sit on a lead if they can get one. They're already down in this one.
Well, they say that Ray Shepard actually deflected in the shot from Aaron Ward. So Ward will get the assist. And Sergei Fedorov gets the second assist. So it's Shepard from Ward and Fedorov on the deflection. And here comes Shepard into the zone again. Cuts to the slot. Hebert goes down to make the save. And Troy Loney is back for it. When the Ducks score a goal tonight, this house may come down. They have all sorts of whistles and bells. And you think Comiskey Park in Chicago explodes when they have a home run. You ain't seen nothing yet.
This place will go crazy, no doubt about that.
Dallas Drake to Paul Coffey right in front, and Hebert, I don't think he saw the shot coming, Brian, it just hit him.
Paul Coffey sneaking in from the point right into the middle of the ice, got a nice feed pass, and he let it go quickly, but Hebert did a good job making a save there.
Nicholas Lidstrom fakes the shot, gets around Sean Hill, centering pass, nobody home, and it comes back to center for Paul Coffey.
It looks as though Anaheim is trying to do a good job of reading the play, but unfortunately, I think the wheels are turning mentally too much and the legs aren't turning enough.
A back pass taken there by the Red Wings. Greg Johnson, youngster coming over from the Philadelphia Flyers. They're very high on him. Where's number 23, former North Dakota Fighting Sioux?
We talked to Dino Cicerelli this morning, and he had a lot of good things to say about Johnson. He's been playing with Johnson throughout the preseason. He's been very impressed with him.
Ducks behind their own net. This is David Williams with the puck. Up to center to Tim Sweeney. Right in front. And going down is Peter Ng to make the save. As offside was called anyway, Sacco cruised in. And the Ducks stand the goal by Ray Shepard. Elsewhere around the National Hockey League tonight. Well, we'll get you caught up in just a moment as the faceoff is about to take place. And the final score, the Devils on the road to Washington. New Jersey 2-0 for Jacques Lemaire. Edmonton leading the Islanders 5-1. The Islanders having a rough start to the season. The Black Sox on the road, the White Sox on the road, beating Toronto by a score 6-1. The Blue Jays now lead the ACLS, or ALCS. I'll get it right. It's opening night for us, too, just about. The Blue Jays still lead that series 2-1. The White Sox, the best road team in the American League, with a big road win tonight. Play is back on. Crowd is quiet as Detroit is pressing the attack early. 6 shots to none so far. The Ducks have yet to get an official shot on goal. We played over 5 minutes.
And Detroit's had 3 or 4 very good scoring chances already. The Ducks, as I said before, I think are sitting back and trying to analyze Detroit so much, trying to figure out what they should do defensively. They just haven't got anything going offensively at all. They need to get some puck control out there and get some confidence themselves.
Terry Carter with it at center for Detroit. Red Wings, they think this is a very big game for them, Brian. They've got to go tomorrow night into the Forum at Inglewood. Take on an LA King team that blew a 2-goal lead in the third period and lost their opener Vancouver. And the Kings are going to come out with fire tomorrow night.
That's for sure. Kings dropped their first one, and they'll want to win that one.
The shot taken by Troy Loney is deflected. It goes well wide, so not an official shot on goal yet for the Mighty Ducks. So they put it up on the scoreboard. That thing was not on net. It was about 15 feet wide. They've given the Ducks a credit for a shot on goal. Well, everybody has to get used to hockey in the Anaheim area. Eisenman with a wrist shot just inside the blue line. The Ducks clear it out. The Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, home at their pond, the Arrowhead Pond. They sold the name of the building to a spring water company. And icing the call on the Detroit Red Wings. Let's take a look at the only goal of the game. The shot was taken by Aaron Ward, but it hit something else on the way into the net.
We're going to take a look at it here. We'll see Shepard get his stick on it. It's Ward who just cranks it from the right point. He has his head down. He just knows where the net is, but he can't see it. You can see Hebert, the goaltender, look over his shoulder. He knew it. He caught track of it just at the last second, but he knew he had no chance looking over his shoulder, seeing it go into the twine, and nothing he could do there.
And the official time, 2 minutes, 34 seconds for Ray Shepard. spent 1 year with the New York Rangers, came over, was a big hit in Detroit last season.
Shepherd has played well in a Detroit uniform. He is a guy on this team, but especially is a very solid third-line guy. When he's on a streak, he's a quality first- or second-line guy. When you can have a guy like him on that third line coming through with big goals the way he has in Detroit, it's a great plus.
Johnson over to Drake. Drake the save by D.A. Bear, I'll tell you. Drake Johnson showed excellent speed in helping to set up that scoring chance.
And Drake has great speed himself. Here's another kid who can play center and wing. He set up that three-on-one situation early in the first period. Didn't result in a goal, but he has the playmaking ability and he can score goals himself.
Ducks thought there might be icing, but the linesman says play on, and so Anaheim carries out of its own end. The shot taken by Anatoly Semenov hits a stick, goes well up over the glass and into the crowd. 12:55 left first period. Shepherd's goal has the Red Wings up 1-0. Take a look at the speed of the youngster, Ray Johnson, acquired from the Philadelphia Flyers in a trade.
Johnson does have great speed, and he has the ability to move the puck well, but watch him turn the jets on through the middle of the ice here. Sometimes on television, it's tough to tell how fast the guy is going. You have to measure people by how fast they're going by someone else, and I think you could get an idea of that on that last replay. Johnson with Drake on his wing, and they get a scoring chance.
By the way, they took that shot on goal away from Anaheim. Somebody got the official score and corrected him. It is now officially 7-0 in favor of Detroit.
Now 7-1. They just got one.
Okay, as I'm pointing that out, they do put one in on Peter Ng. Nicholas Lidstrom, team with coffee now. No penalties yet here in the first period. We played about 7.5 minutes. So 5 aside from the opening faceoff. Keith Primo can't control, and the puck comes back over the blue line with Red Wings, rather Ducks, caught in the zone. Hockey Night on ESPN2 with Brian Engblom. I'm Tom Meese. 1-0 the score, and I told you Emilio Estevez and Paula Abdul were here. We turned the lights up to show you that I would tell the truth.
They were hiding the first time, but you found them that second.
Found them. They can't hide from the probing eye of the camera. Sean Hill back to the point. Holder with a shot. Bill Holder, the former Buffalo Sabre. That shot deflected in front. And Keith Primo picks up a loose puck for Detroit. 7-1, the shots on goal so far in favor of the Red Wings. 1-0 Detroit on the goal by Ray Shepard. Dino Cicerelli, key control. Cruising in with a shot to save by Peter Ng. Shot by Holder. Oh, the Ducks nearly got one through a screen that time, as Ng never saw it, and the Red Wings get a bit fortunate.
That's what the hometown fans want to see here. Now Anaheim has got some momentum. They got their crowd back in it. Listen to that. The tempo has come up. And the tempo of the players has come up as well. Two good shots got through to Ng. Ng made the save, but he had to find the puck first. That was the most difficult thing.
And now we have some tempers flaring. Sean Hill for the Anaheim Mighty Ducks and Dino Cicerelli. And the sticks quickly come down. You know, this game does have potential, Brian, for a few pushing and shoving matches with some of the participants on the rosters.
Absolutely. And Dino Cicerelli, it's no surprise, really, that he's in there pushing and shoving. He's one of those guys that's in the face all the time. Here we'll take a look at the last opportunities by the Anaheim Ducks. The initial shot by Ng, and look how far out Ng was of his crease. He has to scramble to get back into position. He's on his knees. The puck is knocked out of the air again, and he's just kind of scrambling to get a chance to get a piece of that puck. Here from another angle, here's the save he makes. He kicks it out front, gets help on the clearing job. Now you see on the corner of the screen there, he was diving back into the net. Here comes the next one. Whoops, he's on his back. The puck's in behind the net, and the Detroit Red Wings are able to control the play and get it out.
And accidentally, Anaheim's Todd Ewan conked Ng on the top of his mask, and I think some of the Red Wings took exception to that. Here comes Detroit 2-on-1. Shepherd with it. He scores off the skates of Guy Hebert. Second goal of the night for Ray Shepherd.
Well, I told you, Hebert had the worst job in the house from the standpoint of pressure, and that one was one he'd like to have back. Shepherd is very deep. He's simply trying to center the puck through the crease area. It hits Hebert on the inside of the foot and goes into the net.
So Ray Shepherd 2, the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim nothing. We'll take another look at it.
Here we go with Detroit on the attack. The turnover outside the blue line is what creates this opportunity. Shepherd attacking on the right wing side. You'll see him trying to center it. You see Fedorov on the edge of the crease. He's just trying to center the puck. He wasn't trying to score there, but it went in for him. He's got the magic touch so far.
11 minutes, 13 seconds left to go. First period, shots on goal, 8-3. Detroit, score of the game, 2-0. Red Wings. As Detroit losers on the road in Dallas at the Dallas Stars home opener the other night. Trying to right the ship before heading into the madhouse on Manchester to battle Gretzky and the boys tomorrow night. And it's Fedorov behind the net, taken out of the play by David Williams. Williams is bounced hard in the boards by Bob Probert. Here come The Mighty Ducks with a shot from just inside the blue line was Mark Ferner. And a whistle. Well, we have a stoppage in play with 10:44 to go in the period. A reminder that ESPN2's coverage of the National Hockey League continues from Madison Square Garden in New York on Monday night. The New York Rangers, who even there slated 1-1 with a victory over Tampa Bay last night, entertained the Washington Capitals. Al Iafredi, Mark Messier, just two of the many stars will be on display. Here's Julian Jim Schoenfeld will be in Madison Square Garden for the action, 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific. Join us 3 games a week as the deuce is loose in the NHL.
And that game, the Ranger game, every Ranger game will be interesting, especially early on in the season with the new coach behind the bench.
The hitting picks up. This is Stu Grimson. Speaking of hitting, he actually tried to execute a centering pass, and it was a good one right in front of Peter Ng, but the Red Wings clear it. Alexei Kasatanov, the former New Jersey Devil, spent years, of course, with the Central Red Army team of the Soviet Union, the former Soviet Union. Chiasson now behind his own net. Chiasson avoids the check of Stephen King. There's a loose glove on the ice. It's 2-on-2 into the Mighty Ducks zone. Johnson sends it into the corner. Grimson can't clear it. And now Anaheim will break out. Stu Grimson with it. Former Chicago Blackhawk and Edmonton Oiler. Now Sean Hill sends it into the corner. Crowd very quiet. Bit back to their heels. I think they got all hyped up with the pregame show, and now the inevitable disappointment when the home team falls behind.
Well, that's bound to happen. It was quite a pregame show, no doubt about that. Very tough on the players. We mentioned that. They're sitting there waiting to get going in this game. Rookies in this game, we mentioned, they want to just get going with their first ever game in the NHL, and they're forced to sit back there and wait. They're finally getting it going, but it's a difficult situation for all the guys involved, and it looks as if Anaheim is really trying to get themselves going, but they just can't get anything going offensively.
And there's a big hit by Van Allen, Sean Van Allen, that had the crowd ooing and awing. By the way, I want to correct myself. I said Grimson is a former Blackhawk and Oiler. He is a former Blackhawk. He never played for Edmonton. I was thinking of Dave Manson.
Right.
And there's our score with a little bit more than 9 minutes to play here in the first period. National Hockey Night on ESPN2. Late night edition for those of you on the East Coast. Prime time here on the West Coast. The debut of the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. For Brian Engblom, I'm Tom Meese. Glad you could be with us this evening for a very special event. Hope you've been with us since the beginning and saw that great Disney production before the game. Keith Primo loses control in the corner. Cicerelli. He'll be in there mucking and grinding for possession of that puck. He's not afraid of the contact in front.
He sure isn't. He's out there right now. He's out there with Primo and Yzerman. Yzerman getting double shifted already early in this game. Scotty Bowman wants this game. He plays his big guys all the time.
What a great scoring chance for Yzerman. Just shot it wide. Now it's Yzerman again right in front. And getting the stick out there to block. It was Bill Holder holding his stick right along the ice. The Red Wings keep the pressure on. Partner at the point. Cross ice pass. Cicerelli behind the net. Yzerman with it. Looking to center. Looking for someone open. The puck is like a magnet on his stick sometimes. Cicerelli right in front. Primo the backhand. And D.A. Bear the save. And our first penalty of the night coming up.
Well, you can see what good, quick movement of the puck and of your feet will do when you're in the offensive zone. Detroit doing a great job of controlling the puck there. Yzerman weaving around. Cicerelli in behind the net, out in front. Primo out in front and back and behind the net. And the Anaheim Ducks were just trying to catch up with everybody. Cicerelli was in the thick of things again. He's always pushing and shoving and on the edge of the crease. He just wants to get that stick down at the ice for that one magic second when he can get the puck on it, and it'll be in the net before you know it. But Detroit moved the puck very, very well there. Yzerman had the puck about half the time that Detroit actually was in possession, and then Primo gets all alone in front of the net. That's a case of Anaheim running around and then running from one guy to the next, then doubling up on Cicerelli, leaving Primo all alone.
Well, the Red Wings will be on the power play as we come back to live action, and in front, just shooting it wide for the Red Wings was Sergei Fedorov. Sean Hill gets 2 minutes for holding at 11:31, so it's a 5-on-4 advantage for the Detroit Red Wings. Lidstrom and Coffey on the back line. It's Shepard with Fedorov, and Cicerelli, I believe, is the other skater. No, not Cicerelli. Well, we'll get that straightened out in a minute as the Red Wings get a line change. You have Dallas Drake out there now. Drake and Shepard and Fedorov. Here comes Coffey into the zone on the left wing. This time his shot is wide. Drake is there. Nicholas Lidstrom's got a good shot from the blue line. Lidstrom cruises in, lets one go. Hebert makes the initial stop. The rebound comes out to Drake, and Hebert is there with a glove hand. He's getting a lot of work early.
Detroit has an awesome power play. These guys are really good. Paul Coffey back on the point along with Lidstrom. These guys can both move the puck. Paul Coffey, the all-time leading scoring defenseman in the NHL history, he can do it all. He can shoot, he can pass, he can make plays. He's got great speed. Up front, they got Yzerman and Fedorov. They had Drake out there. Now Shepherd has replaced him. We take a look at the replay there. Detroit started it from the point, then they got down low, swarmed it. Hebert was able to cover up. He looks like he's back on top of his game, though, after some nerves early on.
Well, the top power play in the league last year, the Detroit Red Wings, as Shepherd puts it in there. Drake is there for the rebound. Hebert covers up again. 25% they scored on the power play last year. They're 0 for 3 coming into this game tonight, however.
Well, Detroit moves the puck so extremely well out there, and I think that Anaheim has to make their decision when they're killing these penalties, Tom. Are they going to hold a tight box and let them try and move it around the outside? If they do that, then what they give up is some pretty good one-time shots from low down, and that's kind of tough.
You can see last year, 113 power play goals in the season. That's pretty high. Second all-time for most power play goals in a season. And Scotty Bowman hopes the power play continues at that pace this year.
Well, even though you have great talent out there, you must have a plan. There are so many teams. You can go back to the Oilers when Gretzky and Messier and everybody were there. They had the most skilled team in the league, but they were not the number one power play. Because I don't think they stuck to a plan ever. But Detroit had a great plan last year, and it looks like they have a plan again this year.
Faceoff back to Johnson. Johnson surveying the field. 50 seconds left to go on the penalty to Anaheim, Sean Hill. It's already 2-0 Detroit on two goals by Ray Shepard. In front on the deflection, Cicerelli sends it just wide. And it's Johnson recovering again at center. Chiasson got Primo on the right wing, hits him onside. Primo takes a nice hit from Sacco, number 14. Chiasson keeps it in just barely, and the Ducks finally clear the zone with 28 seconds left in the man advantage for Detroit. Sacco dumps it in for a line change for Anaheim. Yzerman, Primo, and Cicerelli out there on the forward line on this power play opportunity. One good chance, maybe, with 12 seconds left to go, the man advantage. Under 10 now. Cicerelli to Yzerman, 5 seconds to go in the power play. Chiasson will wind up. Guy Hebert saw it all the way, and he hangs on just as the penalty to Sean Hill expires.
Nice job there by Anaheim to keep the box and then cover the guy in front of the net.
Entertainment here at the pond. Those lovely ladies with that gentleman with the guitar. Those are that's the Iceman and the Duck cheerleaders, the decoys.
That's a new one. I've never seen that in the NHL.
Last time I saw cheerleaders was at a college hockey game, University of Minnesota. But the decoys, I like that.
Decoys, and they're getting some attention out there. There's
yes,
no doubt. They're keeping things moving in between. While we're on commercial breaks on television, the players are standing around, and I imagine that perhaps once in a while the players are looking up to see what the decoys are doing.
Well, yeah, you do need a break from work now and then, don't you?
That's right.
Stu Grimson sitting on the Mighty Duck of Anaheim bench. A lot of people felt that he and Mr. Probert may get to know each other up close and personal before the night is out.
That's right. Grimson is a funny guy, too. He had a comment the other day saying that things in Chicago are really tough. People are really upset. They've lost both number 23s now. First they lost me, and then Michael Jordan.
Oh, yes. That is a pretty good sense of humor when you think about it. I hope he was kidding. Guy Hebert to Sean Hill. As the Ducks get it out of the zone, the Red Wings dominating this game, as frankly you would expect they would with their talent. 15-4 the shots on goal department, 2-0 where it counts. Guy Hebert has played very, very well in net so far for the Ducks.
Well, so far we don't see any surprises. Detroit's the one that's controlling the pace of the play. These are the guys with the most talent, and they have the ability to move up the ice with the puck, make the plays that they want. What Anaheim is trying to do is read the play and turn the pucks over. Unfortunately, they're still just not mustering enough offense out there to give themselves any confidence to get anything going consistently inside Detroit's zone.
Now here's David Williams in front, deflected by Gary Volk, but it can't get on the goaltender Peter Ng with any kind of steam, and he steers it to the corner. And Ron Holgaard's going to call his second penalty of the night. His bodies were flying. Now here's Grimson. He wants Probert. Here we go. But the linesman step in before a punch can be landed.
Well, you had to know that was going to happen. And Probert is willing to oblige him anytime. These guys have met before, not in very cordial circumstances. Grimson got the gloves off. Probert got the gloves off with the two linesmen right there, and he just didn't let them go at it. Maybe they just want to build this up a little bit. Maybe we'll see it by the second or third period, but not just yet.
This is Disney. Everything has to be done in acts. You know, you have the preliminary, then you have the middle act, and you have your grand finale. Grimson trying to create some havoc out there.
He certainly is. He's spinning around there, just trying to make contact. He realizes that his club has not got anything going. What they need to do, on top of stirring things up with some good body contact, which Grimson was attempting to do, is get the puck deep in Detroit's zone and do some cycling. In other words, just get it in the corner. They don't have to make a great play. They don't need to throw it in front of the net even. They just need to get going in the corners, get some time of possession inside Detroit's zone, get a few faceoffs there, and you never know what'll happen.
That's head coach Ron Wilson of the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim calling his whole experience one that he would never forget. He really embraces the whole idea that Disney is after here, the marketing aspect along with the hockey aspect. He knows that eventually he's going to have to win to keep his job here, but he knows right now the most important thing is to be competitive and put a good product on the ice for family entertainment here in the Anaheim area.
And it's quite a situation for him, too. Both his father and his uncle were players and coaches for the Detroit Red Wings.
And Ron Wilson's uncle is here in attendance tonight. It'll end up a Detroit power play here. You've got Stephen King also getting a penalty. 2 minutes for roughing on Probert. Grimson gets roughing. And so King gets a minor as well. So you wash that all out. And it's a power play for the Detroit Red Wings. Grimson 2 for roughing. King 2 for holding. Probert 2 for roughing at 14:48.
Well, the dreaded power play comes out again for Detroit, so Anaheim back in the same situation. I expect they'll probably experiment a little bit. Sometimes they'll try and hold the box. I think they're afraid, though, to start running around inside their own zone too much, especially when Fedorov is out there and Yzerman, because these guys are so skilled. What they'll want to do is draw them out of that box, out towards the blue line or deep in the corner or over to the far boards, and then throw the puck in the middle to people filling those gaps. I think they're probably going to play a little bit more conservative and stay in a situation in the middle of the ice. Here in this situation, they're only going to have three players out there. It makes it that much more tough.
A very rare situation. 4-on-3 in favor of the Red Wings here. Dallas Drake along with Fedorov. This is Paul Coffey who can really motor. End to end, this is Fedorov back past to Yzerman. Yzerman, top of the faceoff circle, down low. Yzerman looks. And a scores. The Red Wings play tic-tac-toe and go up 3-0. Yzerman with a beautiful pass for the goal by Fedorov. Sergei Fedorov makes it 3-0 Detroit.
We'll take a look at the replay here. 5-on-3 situation against this group of guys is really tough. Yzerman on the left point, fakes passing it across, gets that one-timer. Fedorov has a chance to just move back into the open area. There's a big area across the slot area. That pass probably wouldn't work in a 5-on-4 situation, but when there's only three guys out there, Yzerman is smart enough to know that area is open. Fedorov just one timed it. That's an almost impossible save for the goaltender.
So now it's a 4-on-4 situation. Still a lot of open ice out there, and the Red Wings from Detroit, if you'll excuse the pun, are motoring tonight. Shepherd back to Paul Coffey at the point. Shepherd, who has 2 of the 3 goals, to Dallas Drake. Fedorov cruising in front looking for another, but the Ducks clear it down the ice. Peter Ng, who hasn't had much work tonight, has only faced 4 shots off the sticks of the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, and Ron Wilson's worst fears are confirmed. Not much offense.
No, that's exactly the problem right now. They're going to need to get some consistent play. I don't even care if they get shots. You know, if I'm an Anaheim fan, I'm an Anaheim coach, I'm thinking, get in there, try and get something going inside the offensive zone.
Take another look at the goal by Fedorov, assist to Yzerman and Shepherd.
When you only have three guys out there and you got Shepherd back here in the corner, throws it out to Yzerman. Yzerman, one of the best passers in the NHL. He fakes, he gets Anaheim guys moving just a little bit, then throws it down to Fedorov. The goaltender has to track the puck. He's looking at the blue line, then he has to slide from his left to his right. Just can't quite do it. Once he slides across, he's got to hope that puck hits him. It didn't.
And the Red Wings, for some reason, ended up icing the puck, and that's why the faceoff is in the Detroit zone. It is now a 5-on-4 situation in favor of Detroit. Yzerman behind the net. This is Nicholas Lidstrom with it. Shepherd, 2 goals and 1 assist on the night. Fedorov has a goal, 3-0 Detroit, under 4 minutes to play, first period. Yzerman in front, centering pass, and almost another goal. Primo, he'd have controlled that pass. Could have
calmly dinked it into the net. Eisenman backhands it down into the corner again.
Red Wings, really, it's almost like the ice is choking the way they own the territory on this power play.
It's really tough on them out there, the Anaheim players. Down low, you must play man for man, and they're really having difficulty sorting that out, going from zone play up high to man down low.
Cicerelli looked like he was skipping rope, getting out of the way of that last shot by Eisenman. Here's Cicerelli on the doorstep again. Lattisour buries him into the boards, and that brings a rise out of the crowd. Coffey just keeps it in the zone onside. And now the teams are five aside again with 3:12 left to go here in the first period. Ducks will try to clear the zone now as they have evened up the man advantage. Corkum does clear the zone, but he pays the price. Eisenman, even though he fell, I think he gave Corkum the better of that hit. Paul Coffey catches up to the loose puck at his own zone before Stephen King can get there. Dillinger will dump it in. The Red Wings will go for a chain on the back line. Crowd a bit quiet the way Detroit has been dominating this period. 18-4 now, the shots on goal. King, he's in there onside. Stephen King can't get a return pass. Puck comes back out to center. Hebert has to come out to play it. With Johnson bearing down, 2:12 left in the first period. I'm loaded with those, Brian. You'll find that out.
I'm starting to find that out, yeah.
My library of puns, there are no good ones, just poor ones. However, I defer to Mr. Olbermann, the all-time champion. I know I'll hear about that. Face-off in the duck zone. Sean Hill goes back to the corner to get it. Greg Johnson. As it taken away, Troy Loney with a shot. It's wide. Boy, the crowd ooing and aahing in anticipation when the Mighty Duck even comes close to the opposition net. Semenov with the backhand doesn't get through. Loney can't control, and Johnson with it for Detroit. Under 2 minutes to go now, first period. And the Anaheim Mighty Ducks, or the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, if you will, are finally a reality. October 8th, 1993. A blistering shot by Hill from the blue line, and Ng comes out, catches it, and shows it to Troy Loney as if to say, here it is.
Well, I think if Scotty Bowman would probably like Ng to keep that play moving. Anaheim has not had any sustained attack inside the Detroit zone to speak of at all, so why give them the chance on your own? Drop the puck down to your defenseman. I realize that you don't want to take any chances, but here on the replay, we can see the shot in by Hill. Hill takes it, and Ng gloves it. He looked like he had maybe trouble with it just for a touch, for a second. Loney was coming in, but really, he still had lots of room to work with to drop the puck in the corner, I think. And I think it would have been better, perhaps, if he did drop it down and let Detroit get out of their zone.
See the shots on goal indicating how the Detroit Red Wings are overpowering the expansion Ducks tonight. Florida Panthers have already played two games. They tied their opener in Chicago Stadium and were beaten by the St. Louis Blues last night at the arena. Their home opener is coming up this coming week. Sergei Fedorov deep in his own zone. Tries to clear and hits the arm of Sacco. Offsides the call. We'll have a faceoff with 1:09 left to go in the period. There's the veteran Sacco. He came over to the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. Former Toronto Maple Leaf player was picked up in the expansion draft. 6'1", 195-pounder. Kasatanov dumps it into the zone, hits a chink in the boards, and comes out at an odd angle. It's in the faceoff circle. Ducks have it. The backhand shot in front. Oh, just wide. I'll tell you, had a great chance with Bob Corkum, number 20. It's Sacco with it now. Almost a fluke goal as that entry pass hit a chink in these new boards here and came out flush to the faceoff circle. No two sets of boards are alike.
I've only seen one game in this building so far this year prior to tonight, Tom, and it happened a lot in that game. When the puck is shot around, it takes funny bounces and comes out right in the slot area sometimes.
Red Wings dump it in under 30 seconds left in the period. Been a good one for the Red Wings of Scotty Bowman trying to even their season's record. They lost to the Dallas Stars just a couple of nights ago. As Eisenman touches up, icing the call on the Mighty Ducks with 13.9 seconds left in the period.
And a reminder, Sports Night on ESPN2 tomorrow night. Tune it in, won't you? 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific, hosted by Keith Olbermann and Susie Colbert. 3 hours of news, highlights, and interviews delivered with a healthy dose of humor, wit, and yes, poor puns from the prince of poor puns, Keith Olbermann. That's tomorrow night, 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific. 3 hours on Sports Night, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Not just the scores and highlights. You get those? You get a different perspective on the sports world as well. Face off to the right of Hebert. Keith Primeau controls for Detroit. Back to Coffey. Coffey lets one go. Hebert goes down to make the save. He's played well this period. 3-on-2. 5 seconds left in the period. The other way. Here come the Ducks. Semenov in front. A backhander. Ing makes the save, and that's the period. Oh, my. Anaheim almost got on the board. Their nicest play of the evening. And the crowd hooing and eyeing as the buzzer sounds to end the period.
Anaheim waits till the dying seconds of the period to get it going, but that's what they need to do in this second period is get some rest, come out here and make some plays like this. Semenov getting it to Sweeney down low. Sweeney with...
And that's why ice hockey is called a spectator sport.
Well, the arena here at Anaheim, the fans are visiting the souvenir stands and the concession stands, and we lost some power here at our booth. We're having some technical difficulties. The Stars, you now have teams, of course, in the Miami area with the Florida Panthers and the Tampa Bay Lightning and the Tampa St. Pete area. A lot of teams now as the National Hockey League continues to expand its footprint across the United States in traditional non-hockey areas, hoping to turn them on to the sport of the 90s. 3-0 Detroit after one period. 3-0 Detroit leads it on a pair of goals early in the game, then a power play marker by Fedorov to make it 3-0. Other action tonight, the Northlands Coliseum at Edmonton. The Oilers are pounding the Islanders. Let's join Jigs McDonald and Ed Westfall to check in on that one. Well, we'll join them in just a moment. So you can imagine opening night here at the Duck Pond. Everybody sort of has to get their act together. We found that out trying to drive into the parking lot tonight, Brian.
That's true. Things are going to break down. They have a situation here where a lot of new things. Everybody is starting from scratch in every way. I was in here about a week or so ago, Tom, doing the radio broadcast for the Kings, and they brought the lights down before the game to do some things on the ice, and the press box blacked out too. So things are going to happen like that. There's going to be some glitches, and they'll get them worked out.
Well, it's supposed to be catching because the Gremlins, I think, were 3-1 favorites tonight, and they're covering the spread. Losing power, we have no monitors up here in the booth, so we're sort of flying blind and hoping to match the pictures that you're seeing from our cameras who haven't lost.
And Hoag up front, Malakoff and Kasparaitis on defense. Steven Rystick handling around Hoag. And Kasparaitis takes a hit from Waite as he wheeled it around toward Marty McGinnis. And Seager on him. And the 10 moving it back to Joseph, covering the right point.
I think saw what happened except for the man with the whistle and the armband. Crowd hooting and hollering. Just the net. Why was that set up beautifully by Absuda?
Action, Brian Engblom, for the first goal of the game. They gave it to Ray Sheppard, but they've changed their minds.
That's right. We thought it was deflected, and it certainly was, but I believe it went off an Anaheim player. And even on the replays, we were looking for it. We couldn't see the call. So Sheppard must have spoken up and said, hey, I never touched that one. Ward does get credit for it.
So Sheppard has one goal. Aaron Ward has another goal. And Sergei Fedorov has the third goal as we start the second period of action here at the Duck Pond. New building opening up. They've had a minor power failure in part of the press box, but the lights in the building, thank goodness for the game action for the fans, have remained on. Shot from just inside the blue line for the Mighty Ducks by Alexei Kasatanov. That had some steam on it. Here come the Red Wings. Chase on. He's going to be double-teamed, and he gives up the puck in the corner. Johnson gets it back out to chase on at the point. This is Sillinger with it. Now breaking in Konstantinov for Detroit. Dallas Drake centering, but nobody home, and the Ducks will come out of it 3-on-3. Semenov centering for Troy Loney and Terry Yake. Semenov inside the blue line. His shot bounces off Konstantinov, and Anatoly Semenov has to go back for it.
If I was Ron Wilson, the coach of the Anaheim Ducks, I would go to my best playmakers out there in that first intermission and say, guys, hang on to the puck. Just go out there, have some fun, try and take some of the pressure out there off some of the younger guys. Handle the puck, try and make some plays, and do something in the offensive zone, because it just wasn't working what they were doing in the first period, sitting back and having to handle all of Detroit's offense.
The Natalie attired Ron Wilson behind the bench as the offsides call is made. The scoring summary of the first period, remember now, change that first goal. It's Ward from Shepard and Fedorov. So Aaron Ward scores the first goal. Then it was Shepard at 8:39 from Fedorov and Probert. And then Fedorov from Eisenman and Shepard. So Shepard with one goal and one assist tonight. Actually, two assists.
And Detroit really dominated that first period. They were 1-for-3 on the power play, and they had 10 good scoring chances.
All right, the Ducks behind their own net. This is Sean Hill with it. He loses control of Big Bob Probert. Oh, Hill takes on Probert. I'm sorry for laughing, but that was Mutton Jeff. Probert just said, he raised his arm like, get off me, will you please? Leave me alone. Probert and Eric Lindros, maybe the two most imposing physical specimens in the NHL. Here come the Ducks. Losing control of the puck deep in the Detroit zone was Patrick Carnback, and here comes Detroit Shepard. He's in alone. Backhand, and the save made by Guy Hebert.
Guy Hebert with the big save there on that breakaway attempt by Shepard. Shepard all alone. There wasn't an Anaheim player within 30 feet of him.
Patrick Carnback, he winds up, but Coffey caught a piece of his stick and held up that drive. Carnback goes after it, though. Joe Sacco sticks with the play. Probert and Sacco fight for it. Here comes Detroit out to 3-on-2 if they hurry. It's Shepard. Coffey can't quite pick it up, top of the faceoff circle. Sean Hill with it now for Anaheim. Fedorov just pushes him down. We're going to have the Ducks' first power play ever. The Mighty Ducks will draw the penalty. Sean Hill with some good work in his own zone, lugging it out, and a rather ill-advised penalty by Sergei Fedorov will go to the box.
Fedorov will get that penalty. Let's take a look at the replay here by Shepard. Breakaway by Shepard. He is all alone. He tries to pull the puck to his backhand. Guy Hebert did a great job there. He got out above the top of his crease and backed in with the guy. That's what you have to do. He sticks that right leg out and makes the save. Here's Fedorov on the penalty. He makes the initial bump in the corner, uses the stick a little too much, got it down, and he tripped uphill. He's in the penalty box for a tripping.
Well, one thing we can tell you is we have no stats on Anaheim's power play because this is the first ever. So we don't have to go back and tell you what they've done and what they haven't done. We're going to see what they can do now. You've got Ferner out there on the back line along with Kasatanov. The front line is Troy Loney and Semenov and Terry Yake. So Loney, Semenov, and Yake, the primary scoring threats out there now for the Ducks. I should say the Mighty Ducks. Longtime hockey fans will confuse the Ducks, meaning the Long Island Ducks. Former Eastern League team. Back in the bad old days, Kasatanov just dumps it in at the blue line. Nobody there but Detroit Red Wings, and Detroit easily clears the zone. And as they clear the zone, they send it over a couple of lines, and the faceoff comes back in the Red Wings zone. That's a bit of an ill-advised play.
Yeah, that's true, and even though Anaheim is on the power play here, they have to keep an eye out for Stevie Yzerman. Yzerman is unbelievable shorthanded. He's a smart player. He knows how to play in his own zone. That's one of the reasons he's out there killing this penalty. But when he gets the puck on his stick, even though he is shorthanded, he can turn it into offensive chances. So the Ducks have to stay focused and keep one eye on him at the same time.
Chance for the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim to close the gap a little bit on the shot chart, trailing 21-8 as we speak. Semenov will take the faceoff against Johnson. Semenov wins it back to Kasatanov. Semenov cruising in. The shot is tipped high over the net. Ferner keeps it into the pointer. Does he? No, he doesn't. Sillinger knocks it back out. Kasatanov. Ferner cross-ice pass. Mark Ferner. Journeyman defenseman backhands it into the Detroit zone. And a whistle. No penalty call. His body's hit the ice. Not really sure why they blew the whistle there. I didn't think it was an offside call.
A heavy hit along the end boards, I'll tell you that, but there was no scrap afterwards. Here's you see the Anaheim team dumping the puck in the zone here. goes around behind the net. Konstantinov with his head down trying to play the puck, kind of gets double teamed there, pretty hard hit by Loney. Konstantinov took it on the chin literally on that one. He went down, but he got right back up on his feet. We got a faceoff now outside the Detroit blue line.
And I must admit, I don't know why they blew the whistle there. There was no offside call and no penalty call, and nobody was hurt. But they face off outside the Detroit zone. Chase out of the corner, can't get it out. Sweeney keeps it in. This is Holder. Holder with a shot to the point. It's blunted early by the defense, and the Red Wings knock it out. And over the glass into the crowd for a stoppage.
Bill Holder out there on defense for the Anaheim Ducks had an interesting year last year, played extremely well in San Diego in the minor leagues, and was called up to Buffalo late in the year before the trading deadline. Did a good job for Buffalo down the stretch. This guy has got a great shot. He is an excellent minor league player, and he's been borderline NHL. He really hasn't probably had anybody to believe in him enough to give him a chance in the NHL, but he's got his golden opportunity here this year in Anaheim.
It was Holder who said he was a little bit embarrassed by the parade yesterday at Disneyland. He said, here we are on these floats waving to all these kids, and they're looking at Goofy. They're not looking at us. He said, how'd you like to play second fiddle to Goofy? He says, I frankly didn't like it. Hope the Disney executives don't read that in the paper. Long pass, try to hit a breaking number 26, Robin Bawa, doesn't connect. This is Sean Hill. Hill fans on his blast from inside the blue line. So the Mighty Ducks don't have a shot in this power play, but another penalty going to be called, I believe, against the Red Wings. With still 20 seconds to go on the penalty to Fedorov, Steve Chiasson is going to go to the box for slashing. A two-man advantage. Have a license plate that says Cold Duck. Figures, Mighty Ducks on ice. Cold Duck. Well, a two-man advantage here for the next 20 seconds. On the penalty to Chiasson, Holder cruises in, lets one go. The save by Ing, the rebound. Seven, they score! Sean Hill! The former Montreal Canadian, Sean Hill, has lit up the eyes of the Ducks and their fans with the franchise first ever goal.
It took a 5-on-3 situation, a 5-on-3 power play for Anaheim, but Sean Hill breaks the ice for the Anaheim Ducks, and he gets a standing ovation. The play starts with Holder from the point, using that big shot that we talked about just a minute or so ago, and Hill moved in below the top of the circle there on the right wing side, just too many bodies in front. Peter Ng was down in the original shot. He gets back up quickly, but there is a chance down low, and Ng cannot make the save. Anaheim's on the board.
And celebration all around. Yank, seven off. Sean Hill, and they're rocking the pond. And because that goal was scored before the penalty to Fedorov expired, the Mighty Ducks are still on the power play for a minute 40. Now the Red Wings putting on some pressure in the Mighty Ducks zone, and Dallas Drake had a centering pass that almost hit a body and trickled in, and Anaheim gains control. Over the stick of Loney into the Detroit zone. Ing has to come out to play it. And Dallas Drake tried to clear it, couldn't do it. Yank back to Holder. It's still in. Sean Hill again with some room. The blast and Peter Ng the save. And a whistle. No! No! Is it a goal or not? I thought I heard a whistle. The fans think it's a goal. Is Hogarth going to credit a goal or not?
I don't think so. I don't think so. He's kind of looking at the linesman for a second here. Well, we'll see what the official call is going to be. The puck certainly went in the net, obviously, but I think the whistle had blown because they're going to face it off to the left of Peter Ng.
I heard a whistle, and that's why I said a stoppage of play, and I looked at the clock to see how much time was left in the penalty, and the clock kept rolling. The whistle had been blown. That's the official ruling. You see, Ng is down. And keep in mind, when the referee loses sight of the puck, he has to stop play.
That's right, and he was behind Peter Ng, and Ng did hit, seem to have it controlled underneath him. Then it was jostled out from underneath him, but the whistle had obviously gone, so Hogarth was in control there.
So a minute 10 still left to go on the penalty to Detroit. Chiasson still in the box, another shot by the Mighty Ducks, and Ng has to make the save.
Detroit accomplished what they wanted to in the first period by getting three goals on the board and try to keep the home team off the scoreboard. Now they've done it on this second period.
Let's listen for the whistle here. Well, don't know if you heard it in that replay, but we heard it up here in the building and in the stands on live action, and I have to agree with Ron Hogarth. That puck was well under control, and he blew his whistle, and just bad luck for the Mighty Ducks. Yeah, right behind his own net. Round the boards to Hill.
50 seconds left on the penalty to Detroit's Chiasson. 3-1 the score now. Power play goal by Sean Hill, the first ever in Mighty Ducks history, and now he's an answer to a trivia question. Holder in front, in the slot. Yake couldn't control it. Terry Yake, who had a 20-goal-plus season for the Hartford Whalers last year, had one right in front, couldn't pull the trigger. The other way, Dallas Drake, his shot is blunted by the defense, and here come the Mighty Ducks, 3-on-3. Cross ice pass, Deloney. Fedorov is there, intercept and clear the ice.
Konstantinov did a good job of standing up as best he could there. Loney had to hold up for a second at the blue line to keep from going offside. He did so, but the pass ended up too far in front of him there, and they missed a scoring opportunity.
Mighty Ducks could get called for icing here as Lidstrom is back to touch up. And with 6 seconds to go in the Mighty Duck power play, faceoff will be in the Anaheim zone. Our roving reporter tonight, Al Morganti. Al, where are you now?
You'll never forget that.
Tommy, I'm on the 200 level here at the pond. I'm with a historic person, Colette Bartram, an usher here. You were the first person hit with a puck. How'd this happen?
I was just watching out for everyone else, and I guess I was watching too far, and I got hit.
And they didn't give you the puck, did they? Bounced off your head, kind of, and went away? Well, ESPN is going to hand you a puck from opening night. Tommy, back to you.
All right, Al, you've always been a very generous man.
Poor lady, that's not something you want to have happen to anybody.
No.
She must have kids. She was looking out for other people, and it hit her. Sounds like a mother to me.
Yeah. You remember the first time you were hit by a puck, Brian, as a player?
No, I try to forget those things. I don't remember the last one either. There was too many in between.
Faceoff comes back to Lidstrom, shorthanded. He got a good drive away, but it never got through to the net. Now the teams are five aside. 3 goals for the Red Wings in the first period. The Mighty Ducks have answered on a power play with Sean Hill scoring a few moments ago. Here's Chiasson. Nice job backchecking there by David Williams. Help break up that scoring opportunity. Ferner has to cover up in his own zone, and a penalty coming up for cross-checking against the Mighty Ducks.
Gary Volk, I think, is going to go for cross-checking. Down low, Steve Yzerman, a little slow getting up. He took a pretty good cross-check across the back. Trainer running out on the ice there. Take a look at Steve. He's their prized possession for the Detroit Red Wings. And I think it's Volk that's going to take that cross-checking penalty.
Back to the Ducks.
Welcome back here to the pond in Anaheim. You'll see the penalty here on Volk. Volk just hammers Yzerman from behind up in the shoulder area, and Yzerman went down hard.
That does hurt. So Detroit on the power play again. Paul Coffey's shot hits a body in front, bumped up to the side boards. Three-man scrum for possession. Detroit comes away with it. Fedorov back to Coffey. Coffey to Fedorov. He's got an open net, and Hebert slides across. Fedorov didn't quite pull the trigger quick enough.
Fedorov had a tough situation there. Paul Coffey with the great fake shot. They had the whole box moving from the near side boards back into position in the middle of the ice. Coffey has the puck at the left point. Coffey ends up with it there. He sets up like he's going to take a shot on net. He's looking out of the corner of his eye. He knows Fedorov is getting in position. There you see Fedorov down low, but it's a hard pass. Those ones have to be controlled first and then shot quickly. Fedorov is trying to do that, keep an eye on the goaltender, Hebert, at the same time. He knows Hebert is out of position. He just can't quite get it under control. He knows he's got to shoot now. He shoots really before he has it on his stick, and he just doesn't get the chance he wants.
You see the facts and figures on the Detroit power play for the night and the season. They moved the puck exceptionally well. They've got a ton of shots on the power play tonight. And that's the key thing. You want scoring opportunities. Sooner or later, the pucks are going to go in. The Ducks clear the zone. Still shorthanded for another minute 27. Good drive away on Peter Ng, but Ng is there for the save. Ducks intercept. Terry Yake with it. Yake is the man who got the good shot away a moment ago, but he couldn't control. They really think Terry Yake could blossom here into a 30-goal-plus scorer this year.
That's what they really want from him. He scored 22 goals in Hartford last year. They're trying to project him as a 30-goal scorer, give him some confidence and some ice time, which is always what you need in order to become a goal scorer in that range.
Fedorov into the zone, minute to go on the penalty against the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. Fedorov again on the doorstep. He was wide open at half the net to shoot at, but again, cannot control the pass from Coffey. They try to hit Fedorov again. Nobody's bumping Fedorov out of the way. He's the guy that the Ducks are just leaving uncovered. An errant pass is picked up by Bill Holder. The long shot in on Ng. And the Ducks will get fresh troops out there. 30 seconds left to go in the Detroit power play. Coffey wheeling and dealing on the wing. Coffey behind the net. Sean Hill takes it away from him, and the Mighty Ducks clear the zone.
That was one of the few times you'll ever see Coffey go to the left wing side. He loves to attack on the opposite side, but he had so much room to work with on that left side that he just got in there and blasted one.
Close call for Peter Ng. Joe Sacco intercepted the pass at center, wanted a line change, dumped the shot in, and you know what? Ng appeared to be a little bit baffled by it.
That one seemed to change direction. I don't know if it skipped or what, but it seemed to fool him for a second. He misjudged it.
Teams are back to five aside. Randy Lattisura with it for Anaheim. Gary Falk out of the penalty box. David Williams bumped off the puck. Sillinger has it to center for Keith Primo. And breaking in for Detroit is Vyacheslav Kozlov, and a score for the Red Wings as they up it to 4-1. A burst of speed by Vyacheslav Kozlov. Results in a goal for the Red Wings.
I think Primo may end up with the goal in this one. It's the initial chance from Kozlov. We'll watch this on the replay as Detroit is on the attack. The speedster number 13, Kozlov, attacking on the right wing side. You'll see big Primo going to the net with his stick down. That's the key. It goes in off his, he gets it under control with his feet, and he's able to kick it up onto his stick just in time to have enough angle left to get it by Hébert. There you see it, off the feet, onto the stick, and over Hébert's leg. It's 4-1 now for the Wings.
So Keith Primo gets the goal. Kozlov on for one of his rare shifts of the night. I was looking down at the lineup, checking his number to make sure I had the name right, and in that time he got the pass to Primo, and Primo put it in. Kozlov the only assist in 8 minutes and 39 seconds. It's a 4-1 hockey game. So the Red Wings strike back. It was not a power play goal. Game in a 5-on-5 situation. Primo with it again. Gets it to Kozlov. The blast is just wide. Wow, Hébert left half the net to shoot at that time, and it's lucky the Red Wings missed it.
And Sillinger just missed a good chance there. The puck came off the near side boards.
Todd Ewan with a blast. Stick save by Peter Ng. And another penalty coming up on Anaheim. Yes, cross-checking will be the call as Chiasson is knocked down behind his own net. And Gary Falk is going to get the gate again. He's got to keep his stick down.
Yeah, he nailed the second straight player, and he's going to be in the box for the second straight time.
Call coming into the pond tonight. Gentleman with a Toronto Maple Leafs jersey. His son hasn't had too much chance to blow that duck call tonight.
No, he sure hasn't, but they have improved in the second period over the first.
Yes, they have. The Red Wings still in control by three goals, looking for more as they're back on the power play as Volk is back in for cross-checking. Dallas Drake gets it to the point. Back to Drake. Dino Cicerelli in the corner. Drake to Lidstrom. Lidstrom the drive in front. The deflection attempt by Cicerelli goes awry.
Detroit got the situation they wanted. Cicerelli was right in the face of Hébert. He'll do that consistently, even though he's not a big man. He'll stand in there, take a pounding, dish out his own licks, and he'll be in there for rebounds every time.
This is National Hockey Night on ESPN2. Here at the Duck Pond in Anaheim, the inaugural game for the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. Lidstrom the blast. It's wide. Dallas Drake the rebound. Can't get it on net. Lattisura got down, cut a piece of it. With Brian Engblom, I'm Tom Mees. ESPN2 proud to be here for this historic moment in the National Hockey League as the Anaheim Mighty Ducks, just awarded the franchise less than a year ago, are now in action. Lidstrom shot to save. The Red Wings have controlled the play for much of the night, leading it 4-1, still in the power play for 50 seconds. Anaheim fans getting antsy. They want the Ducks to clear the zone, if nothing else. Detroit just passing it around at will. This makes the defense tired, too. Dallas Drake in front. Cicerelli, another deflection attempt. Yzerman is there for a backhand attempt. He's back on, and a whistle.
Number 22, Cicerelli, hanging around the edge of the crease. Detroit moving the puck around extremely well. And, of course, you have a lot of new fans here in Anaheim, a lot of people who don't really know the game. They're watching their team kill off a penalty, and a lot of them, I'm sure, are wondering why they're not going after these guys. They just don't know how the game works sometimes. We're watching the replay now. Detroit just moving the play around, and it looks as if they're doing it at will. And I'm sure there's a lot of people all sitting out there saying, why are they staying in that box shape, and why are they not running after the puck or trying to turn it over? And it's obviously because they're a man short.
And the faceoff to the right of Guy Hébert. Sometimes the best way to play a man short is the box. Let the other team take the shots as long as you keep the screens out of the way of the goaltender. Let him see it. Let him do what he's paid to do, and that's make the save.
That's exactly right. That's what they want from Hébert. Hébert's got to make that first save, and hopefully they'll get there in time to clear any rebounds or eliminate any second or third shots. But with the likes of Drake's or Cicerelli or guys like that hanging around there so consistently, that's a tough job in itself.
Well, those guys will brag to their friends for the next 10 years. They caught a puck, a real one, not the ceremonial ones they were given as they came in the door. A real one behind the net. I was disappointed they didn't make that old announcement. You know, the one where you go to the hockey rink and they say, everywhere, they say, management will cheerfully refund your money in That's case right. you want to leave, because they say, we're not responsible if the pucks go flying in the stand.
That's right. Nobody was hurt there, thank goodness, and good souvenir for those fans.
Face-off in the Mighty Ducks zone, 20 seconds still left on the penalty to Anaheim's Gary Falk. Keith Primo is bodied hard by Bill Holder. Crowd love that. I think they'd like to see more of the physical play for the home team. I think as the game of the season goes along, they're going.
That's right, especially when you pick on a big guy, and Primo is one of the biggest out there. He took a pretty good lick from Holder.
The penalty is over. The teams are five aside. Falk is back on the ice. So no damage done there to the home club. Primo taken to the boards again, this time by Sean Hill. Here's Chiasson on the doorstep, and he scores as Hebert never had a chance. Play developing behind the net, and the puck comes to the slot area where Steve Chiasson walked in and said thank you very much and deposited past Hebert. At least one guy's happy about that.
That's right. Chiasson with a great shot, but excellent work down low by Detroit. They just moved that puck around, and Chiasson sees the opportunity. He moves right into the prime scoring area. The Anaheim Ducks went to sleep here. They had enough guys inside their zone. Here's the replay. We have Primo. There's body contact. Hill trying to do a good job of turning the puck over, but he can't get to it. There's the puck thrown back to the point. Chiasson sneaking in. The shot in the top shelf. Great shot by Chiasson.
So the Red Wings are cruising, and here they come again. Sillinger almost walked in on Guillebert. Chiasson gets the goal. Probert with a shot. Stick save made by the goaltender. Actually, that wasn't Probert. That was Micah Ivazov. Micah Ivazov with his first shift of the night. There's a stoppage by Ron Hogarth. We understand our roving reporter Al Morganti is in the stands somewhere here at the Duck Pond. Al, where are you? What are you doing?
Tommy, in the sea of Duck shirts, I find a Red Wing shirt. You're in dangerous territory.
Especially now, it's 2-0. Catching a lot of flack behind me here.
He had a chance to get with a new team, grab a new bunch. He's sticking with the Red Wings. Tom, back to you.
All right, Al, I think he picked the right one tonight, but he didn't have the score right. It's 5. How many beers has that guy had? It's 5-1.
He's having a good time. He doesn't care. Guillebert was shaken up a little bit there, Tom, on that last shift. He was crashing into the net. The net was knocked off its moorings. He's shaken up. He's still down on his knees. The Duck trainers are out there taking a look at him right now. Try and figure out what exactly happened to him, whether he's got a back injury or perhaps a hip injury.
Other scores around the NHL tonight, the New Jersey Devils.
A knee injury there. Lidstrom ends up right on top of him, and Hebert is down on all fours. He's on his knees to make the save, and it looks as if Lidstrom landed on his thigh area. That, to me, would look like a knee strain.
Red Wings control the faceoff, and Hebert has to cover up again. I'll tell you, Detroit knows something about goalies being injured. In their opener at Dallas, they lost Tim Cheveldae for a week to 10 days, maybe longer, with a knee strain.
That's right. Guy Hebert has been a busy man out there. 20 shots in the first period, 11 shots in this second period, 31 shots already. Anaheim, 15 shots so far in this game.
Anaheim Ducks control the faceoff and move it out to center. It's 3-0 Detroit after one. The Ducks made it 3-1 on the power play goal by Sean Hill, but the Red Wings have answered back with two of their own. It's a 5-1 hockey game. And wheeling and dealing is Greg Johnson. Sillinger behind the Anaheim net, can't control. Aaron Ward with it. He got the scoring started early on in the first period. Sillinger. Semenov gets buried after getting rid of the puck. Bob Probert took him out of the play. This is Semenov back in the Detroit zone, trying to get around Konstantinov, who buries him. There's a loose stick on the ice. Somebody's out there without some lumber. Troy Loney, the captain of the Mighty Ducks, into the corner. Puck comes to Kasatanov back with it. Looking. The former New Jersey Devil has his pass in the skate of a Detroit player, and Sillinger with it at center. Konstantinov, the save by Hebert to the side boards. Bob Corkum, cross-ice pass to Gary Falk. Ing wings it around behind the net. And the Red Wings clear the zone with 6:20 left to go here in the second period. Delayed offsides is waved off now as Konstantinov gets it out to Probert. Cardion for his first shift of the night for the Red Wings. Probert, nice pass at the chase. Otto winds up again, hits somebody in front. Of here come the Mighty Ducks, 2-on-2. Todd Ewan races after it. Chason takes him out. Corkum has it in front. Oh, Gary Volk was in perfect spot for a tipping attempt. Went just wide. Ewan in front again. Volk couldn't get a stick on it.
Anaheim getting a couple chances down low. Volk had that one jump over his stick. He had a golden opportunity. He's right on the edge of the crease. Detroit was looking around for the puck, and they looked at behind the net at the wrong time. Volk was just unlucky. That one bounced over his stick.
Puck at the blue line. It's onside as Drake steals it, but he loses it right back again to Patrick Carnback. Big hit at center ice delivered by Randy Lattisour against Darren Ward. The crowd loves it, and a penalty call now by Ron Hogarth. It's going to come against who?
Replay on the penalty on Kozlov, but leading up to it, watch this hit. Lattisour and Ward hitting each other at center ice. Ward took the brunt of that one. He goes into the glass face first. Right after that is when Kozlov took the penalty for hooking.
So Vyacheslav Kozlov goes for 2 minutes at 14:47 to the Mighty Ducks, who scored their only goal of the night on the power play. 1-for-2 on their extra man chances tonight. 5 shots out of those 2 chances. And wheeling into the zone is Tim Sweeney. Sweeney loses his edge. In front, the backhand attempted a great save by Ng on the shot by Sacco, and he holds on.
Peter Ng, nice save there, as he hasn't had much work in this game, and it's been in sporadic moments. He'll get a flurry of shots and then nothing in between. But he's sharp right here on this play as Anaheim gets a scoring opportunity from in close. A backhand shot shoveled towards the net by Sackle. Sackle gets it under control there, and he's trying to go top shelf. Ng going down on his knees makes the glove save.
Peter Ng, native of Toronto, Ontario. I-N-G is how you spell it. Sean Hill with a blast. Ng on the rebound. Another shot in front, as Carnback had a second rebound attempt. The Mighty Ducks putting the pressure on this power play. Working it around, Holder at the point. He's got a good shot from there. Ng is there for the initial save. Lidstrom trying to cover up for Detroit. Trying to clear the zone somehow, relieve the pressure, and Detroit finally does. 1:05 left and the penalty to Vyacheslav Kozlov. And now the Ducks give it away at center, and Steve Eisenman almost had a walk-in. It hit, deflected off his skate, or else Eisenman had a great chance at a shorthanded goal. This is Holder back with it for Anaheim. He'll dump it in the zone. Troy Loney, Terry Yake with it in the corner. Kasatanov, cross ice pass to Holder. In front, Loney the shot. In comes out, he played that one well, anticipated the shot, and gave Loney very little left to shoot at.
Anaheim moving the puck around much better on the power play. They get a pretty good shot there from a bad angle.
Down the power play for the Mighty Ducks, trying to close the gap. It's 5-1 Detroit. Perrier free in the slot. They can't get the puck to him, and the Red Wings clear it.
You can feel that Anaheim's getting a little bit of creativity going. It's taken them a while, but better late than never. They're moving the puck a little more authority, and you can feel their confidence building here on the power play.
This is Semenov on the right wing. Mighty Ducks have got a break from the schedule maker right away. Brian, they play their first 5 games here at the Duck Bomb before they venture out on the road.
I think they're probably working in conjunction with the Kings there, Tom, because the Kings are home for the first 5 as well.
2-on-1 for Detroit. Johnson keeps it himself, tries to dipsy doodle past the goaltender Guy Hebert, but Hebert wasn't fooled.
Johnson upset with himself there. He had that 2-on-1 situation. He had Drake all alone in front of the net. Drake was trying to get set up for a one-time shot should that pass come across. But Johnson was looking all the way, and I think he made the right decision. He ended up running out of room, though, and he's upset with himself for probably not trying to go in and make a better attempt one-on-one against the goaltender, Hebert. Sometimes you take too long to analyze your own situation and miss a good spot.
Now let's go to our Robin reporter, none other than Al Morganti. Where could he be? Let us find out, Al.
Thanks, Tom. Luxury box is a big part of any arena, and they're great here at the pond. State of the art. I've got my white chocolate mask there, my Arrowhead water, and now back to you up in the other area code.
Wow, your white chocolate mask?
Wow.
My goodness, Easter isn't for a few months.
Nice digs, geez.
Yeah, well, that's, you know, Al's living room is better than that at home. This guy makes the big bucks.
Same size, though.
Yeah. Actually, he's slumming being in a super box, and he has a mansion in New Jersey. Whistle for an offside. Faceoff will come with 2:44 left to go here in the second period. Brian, overall, what are your impressions of what you look at Dino Cicerelli? What are your impressions of the Mighty Ducks' first ever tonight?
Well, a slow start because I think they were just so pumped up. They were wound so tight, and they had to wait so long. It was really a tough first period for them. And Detroit did a smart thing. They didn't play very well in their first game of the year down in Dallas, and they made up for it here. They put the pressure on Anaheim, but Anaheim is starting to recover.
Getting their equilibrium as they pick up a loose puck at center. Gary Falk into the Detroit zone. Over the stick of Ing. Back for it is Micah Ivazov. I have to think before I say that name. It's a very, you look at the spelling and it just doesn't look like it's Ivazov, but it is. Cicerelli. Coffey deep in the Mighty Duck zone. Paul Coffey will get together with his old friends in the LA Kings tomorrow night as the Wings invade the Forum. Here's the shot by Todd Ewan. It's wide as Ing got a pad up in the air, but the shot was well wide. Teams at five aside. Shots are 32-19 in favor of Detroit. Loose puck at center. This is Fedorov. Probert goes with Sean Hill into the corner. Bobby Probert, when he's been on the ice tonight, with one exception, just a little flare-up with Stu Grimson, very, very businesslike.
Well, his team's in the lead 5-1. There's no reason for him to really go out and stir things up. He was willing to oblige Grimson, but the linesman done it way too quickly, and they couldn't go at it.
Sean Hill whips it around the boards, but Chiasson saw that play coming. He intercepts it. Steve Chiasson has one goal tonight in front for Probert, who just couldn't get a stick on it. Bob Probert's got great hands around the net for a big man, and he almost got a great opportunity.
And Chiasson jumped in to play very nicely there and made a nice pass out in front. As you said, it was almost completed by Probert. The puck he was just unable to jam it in from the edge of the crease. But Chiasson already with a goal in this game. That was another nice offensive play by him.
Fedorov takes it from Ward. His centering pass is deflected away, and the Ducks clear the zone. Last minute of play in the first period, as you see it counting down. Make it the second period. And icing the call on the Mighty Ducks with 35.7 seconds left here in the second.
Anaheim had some momentum going in the second period when they got some power play chances, a few things offensively. They got their crowd into it, but more importantly, they got themselves into it with that offensive confidence, the ability to handle the puck, move it around, and know you can do it. Now they've fallen off again here in this last couple of minutes, and Detroit again moving the puck around pretty effectively inside the Anaheim blue line.
And the faceoff will come to the left of Guy Hebert, who's seen 32 shots tonight, stopped 27 of them. But really, of the five goals, I don't think you could call any of them a bad goal against Hebert.
No, that's true. And I talked to Brian Hayward, who's the goaltender coach for this Anaheim team, and he knows what it's like to play on a new franchise team. He's gone through it all. I said, how do you handle it when you're going to have those nights where you're just going to get shelled by about 45 shots and you might lose by 6 or 8 goals? He said, there's no doubt it's tough. And he said, we're going to deal with it on the basis that you're not judged so much on whether you won or lost, because that's just not fair to the goaltender. You really have to be judged on how many goals were your fault. Take them apart and see if you did your job.
Peter Ng stopping play with 15.3 seconds left, covering up as he saw one of the Mighty Ducks, Joe Sacco, steaming down the slot. So the faceoff in the Detroit zone.
Peter Ng likes to hold on to that puck. That's pretty obvious in this game. He does not throw it away unless he's absolutely sure that his player can get it. Early in the first period, I point out that there was one time in particular where I thought he should have gotten it going to allow his team to get out of the zone quickly and easily, because Anaheim had not been able to muster any pressure. But it's better to be safe than sorry, and Peter Ng has definitely been safe.
Faceoff controlled by Johnson of Detroit, gets it out. Terry Carter hasn't been on in a while. Speeds it ahead. Dallas Drake centering pass, but covering up for the Mighty Ducks is Patrick Carnback. And that'll do it for the second period of play. So the Mighty Ducks, the good news for them in the second period, they get their first ever goal on the power play marker by Hill. But after two, it's all Detroit. Red Wings lead it 5-1.